pKa. Many of you have heard the term before, and most of you probably know that pKa is related to the acidity of a proton. The greater the pKa, the less acidic is the proton, and the less the pKa, the more acidic is the proton. But what you might not appreciate is the implications of understanding pKa. pKa and its applications extend far beyond acidity. Let me give you an example to prove it. So for instance, we think about substitution reactions as the replacement of a leaving group for a nucleophile. How we judge the nucleophilicity and leaving group ability of the nucleophile and leaving group is intimately related to acidity and basicity. So we draw parallels, for instance, between the nucleophilicity of a nucleophile and its basicity. Basicity being inversely related to acidity is, of course, intimately related to pKa. Likewise, we judge a leaving group's leaving group ability by its ability to accept electrons. An analogous process is the accepting of electrons when an acid gives up a proton. So the ability of a group to give up a proton is probably very similar to its ability to act as a leaving group. Notice the identical nature of these two arrows. That's not a coincidence, and there's definitely a correlation between pKa and leaving group ability. This is just one small example that illustrates the far-reaching power of pKa. Of course, its most useful application is in reactions involving proton transfer steps, which are huge in number. There are an enormous number of reactions that involve PT steps because they're very fast, very easy, and often very favorable. In this series of webcasts, keep in mind the importance of pKa as we move forward. You're going to learn a lot about how to determine the acidity and basicity of particular groups, and keep in mind that the end goal is for you to be able to use pKa as a tool that can help you rationalize reactivity trends.